Cromwell Professor of Law here at the law school. And this morning's talk, as I assume you've seen already, is entitled Democracy's Choice, Books or Bumper Stickers. I choose provocative titles intentionally because, although provocative, they're also obscure, and I'm free to talk about pretty much whatever I want. Actually, what you'll be hearing from is a version of a work in progress. I'm working on a book about things democracy needs more of and needs less of, and books and bumper stickers play an important role in the book that I'm writing. The role is partly literal, but it's partly metaphorical. That is, I'm not saying literally there should be no bumper stickers in a democracy, we need a law, or that everybody needs a certain number of books. But there are aspects of books and bumper stickers that represent certain trends in our democracy, one positive, one negative, and I am all for encouraging us in a positive direction. I've been told by those who listen to this talk that I'm oddly optimistic given the trends that I cite. I hope you'll find that that is so. You can tell me what you think. Well, certainly have time for questions when we're done. But to begin my talk, I need to say a few words about democracy itself, because it's a word that's used a lot, and a lot of us mean different things when we say democracy, so it's useful to think about what it is that we mean. A lot of us identify democracy automatically with voting, but this can't possibly be correct. There are plenty of countries in the world that vote, and most of them are not democracies. In the last election in Iraq, before the government was overthrown by the invasion, Saddam Hussein received 100% of the votes, not 96% or 84% or 71%, but 100% of the votes cast. They had an election not recognizably democratic. There was a country in the former Soviet bloc that, when it decided to have its first election, first Western-style election, threw open its doors to Western observers to come and see the election, and one of my colleagues here at Yale was an observer of that election and later came and gave a talk to us about what he'd observed. He was situated in a polling place, he said, where these people, most of whom had never voted in their lives, arrived in the polling place, were given a secret ballot in a sealed envelope, and they went into a sealed room to fill out their ballot, sealed it back in the envelope, came back into the main room, and then, for ease of counting, dropped it into one box of the voting for one party, another box of the voting for the other party, and so on. And part of his point was that he didn't think that this had been consciously designed by the government as a tool of intimidation. They had just never done it before. It seemed to make sense to them as an easy way to count the ballots. Well, whether that's true or not, I think we would not recognize it as a democratic election. It's important to think about what a democratic election is, because it's important to think of the answer to the simple question of why vote. Every year at election time, especially at presidential election time, some of my students come to me and they say, "Oh, Professor Carter, we're not going to be in class for the next 2 weeks because we're going to be getting out the vote in Ohio or Pennsylvania." And I say, "What, you think if you go to your law school classes that fewer people will vote in Ohio and Pennsylvania?" They say, "Yes, absolutely." They say, "What if the election comes down to that one last bus, that one last van carrying people to the polls in some suburb?" And I say, "No presidential election has ever come down to that one last van and one last," but nevertheless, they go off and they do what they think is important. It's not an excused absence, but that's another story. They go off and they do what's important. And then they come back. And I ask them, "Did they have fun?" And they say, "It was great fun." And I say, "Did you influence the election?" They said, "Of course, if not for us, it would have gone the other way," and so on. Us and people like us, they mean. And then they ask me what I think. And I say, "Well, you know, I don't really like to vote. I don't vote unless my wife drags me to the polls and makes me vote." And they say, "Why don't you like voting?" I said, "Well, first of all, it's a waste of time." I said, "What do you mean it's a waste of time?" I said, "Well, my vote doesn't make any difference. I live in a small town, and even in my small town where I live, no election since I've lived there, and I've lived there now 15 years, has ever been decided by one vote. Therefore, it makes no difference if I vote or not." And they say, "Well, that can't be right. What if everybody felt that way?" I say, "Everybody doesn't feel that way. That's why I'm free to not vote if I don't if I don't want to." And then they say, "Well, you know, if you don't vote, you can't complain about the result." And I say, "Watch me." And they give me these various reasons to vote. And What's interesting is that it's actually, although most of us think of voting, we conceptualize it as an obligation, it's not that easy to articulate the reason we ought to vote. So I'm going to give you what I think is the one reason to vote in a democracy, and I want to suggest to you that it is this reason that makes democracy different from other forms of government, and then I'm going to tease out the implications of that reason. This is the one reason. When I vote, I am saying to my fellow citizens, we're all on the same footing. We're all, in some sense, equals. I respect you across our differences, and therefore, to show my respect, as a symbol of my respect, I will take the most cherished issues, the things I care about the most, and lay them on the altar of democracy, invite us to vote on them, provided you will do the same. And I will stand by those results if you will stand by those results. That's what makes voting in a democracy important. The voting itself isn't important because the winning isn't important. In democracy, winning is not a virtue. Winning is the outcome of the exercise of other virtues. What's important about voting in a democracy is what it symbolizes. What it symbolizes is our mutual respect, is our feelings about our fellow citizens. Without that mutual respect, we may vote, but we are not really doing democracy, whatever else it may be that we are doing. All right. So at this point, you're entitled to ask, what on earth does this have to do with books and bumper stickers? Well, I'm going to tell you what it has to do with books and bumper stickers. And the first thing I have to tell you is I like books and I don't like bumper stickers, but you might have gathered that already from the title. Now, I'm biased. I write books. I like writing books. I like reading books. All right, I admit my biases. I've written, I think I've published 11 books, most of them nonfiction, a couple of novels. But the thing that's really important about books is what they symbolize, and the thing that's really important about bumper stickers is what they symbolize. Let's do bumper stickers first. What is the first thing we know about a bumper sticker? That it's on the back of the car. It's on the back of the car. Now think about that for a moment. To put a bumper sticker on the back of the car is to make a statement. The statement is, this is true, and it is so true that I have no interest in anything you might say to the contrary. Moreover, I'm going to force you to look at my view, but I have no interest whatsoever in yours. So from the beginning, the symbol can be undemocratic. I don't mean a bumper sticker can't be clever. I was once, I think it was in Tennessee, and I spotted a libertarian, I think it was a libertarian bumper sticker, which made actually a really very sophisticated argument in just two lines. It said something like, I don't remember it exactly, it was something like, I'll keep my laws off your body if you'll keep your laws off my money, or something like that. See, that's a thoughtful argument. Maybe right or maybe wrong, but it's a clever argument. But I was still bothered by the fact that it's on a bumper sticker. The point about what a bumper sticker symbolizes is that a bumper sticker symbolizes the notion that the complex issues of the day can be reduced to simplicity, to a quick and easy line. Why does that matter? Well, one of the great historians and political theorists of the 20th century was Richard Hofstadter, and he wrote two monographs, very thoughtful ones, one in the 50s and one in the 60s that bear on this. The one in the 50s, which was a book, was entitled Anti-Intellectualism in American Life. The one in the 60s, which has been published in book form but is really a long essay, is entitled The Paranoid Style in American Politics. Each of these pieces, in a different way, made the same observation. The observation was this. And he looked out on America of the 50s or 60s. He argued America was divided into two camps. There was one camp that he called progressive. And what distinguished the progressive camp was its respect for reason and tolerance and dissent. Its belief that what mattered was the argument and that it was wrong to attack one's opponents. Versus the other camp, which he called reactionary, which believed, he said, in applause lines, slogans, emotional appeals, and lists of people to hate. applause lines, slogans, emotional appeals, and lists of people to hate. And in both of these pieces, he argued at great length for why democracy needed the first kind of person, not because of the policies these progressives favored, although he was a progressive himself, but rather because what democracy needed was that belief in reason and tolerance. Without that, he said, you couldn't have a democracy. You simply had mob rule. And one of the problems, the proliferation of bumper stickers with a quick, easy line about every issue under the sun, is that it plays into that second model of a reactionary politics, a politics, as Hofstadter said, of slogans, applause lines, emotional appeals, and lists of people to hate. Hofstadter thought democracy could not long survive if that side became ascendant. And one of my great fears about politics today, about political life today, and indeed about our democracy today, is that that side is ascendant on both sides of the aisle. That is to say that we live in an era where every issue on both sides seems very quickly reduced to applause lines, slogans, emotional appeals, and lists of people to hate. That is the metaphor. That's what I'm representing when I use bumper sticker. On the other side is the book. And the book represents, first and foremost, complexity. Complexity. A book, by its very nature, stands for the notion that there are issues that are difficult. There are issues about which one has to take a long time to get a full understanding. Especially books that are hard, books that are difficult, books that are, if you will, complex. I realize that not all books fit this description any more than all bumper stickers fit the other description, but bear with me while I pursue the metaphor a little bit further. In 1936, when fascist mobs were burning books all over Europe, the French book collector Maurice Robert, trying to get them to stop, warned that your library, he said, is a mirror of your personality, by which he meant, if you're burning the books, quite apart from the substantive issues, that tells us something about the kind of person that you are. Fast forward to the 1950s and the publication of one of the great novels of the 20th century, Ray Bradbury's Fahrenheit 451. Now, most people have probably read Fahrenheit 451. When I talk about it in class, most of my students have read it. But what's interesting about talking to my students about it, what they remember about Fahrenheit 451 is that it was a novel about censorship of books. That's how they remember it. And to describe it that way slightly misses Bradbury's point, which I want to take a moment to articulate here. I assume most of you have read the novel, but if you haven't, Fahrenheit 451 is set in the near future. Remember, it was written 50 years ago, but set in the near future. It's told from the point of view of a man whose job is a fireman. And the firemen in Fahrenheit 451 are the ones who are called when books are discovered, and they burn the books. That's their job. They burn them. Now, what's interesting about the book is that a lot of the book is actually dialogue, the play, interplay between Montag, the firefighter whose mind we're in, and his boss, the fire chief. And what happens is at one point, Montag, the firefighter, wants to know, how did this book burning business start anyway? Why do we do it? And there, the fire chief makes a famous speech in which he says it wasn't about censorship, it wasn't about government control, this was a movement from the bottom up. This is a popular movement. We burn the books because the books are too hard. People, he said, wanted no complexity. They wanted their ideas simple. And that's why we burn the books. The fire chief says, what traitors books can be. You think they're backing you up, and then they turn on you. Others can use them too. And there you are, lost in the middle of the moor in a great welter of nouns and verbs and adjectives. And he goes on to say, books remind us what asses and fools we are. their Caesar's Praetorian Guard whispering as the parade roars down the avenue, "Remember, Caesar, thou art mortal." The things you're looking for are in the world, but the only way the average chap will ever see 99% of them is in a book. But books, we said, are traitors. So the fire chief says the reason we got rid of the books is that books can lead you astray and they're not always on your side. That reading a book, the fire chief emphasized, and Bradbury wrote about this later, can trip you up, can change your mind. When you allow yourself to enter into the complexity of an idea, that complexity changes you. Bradbury's point was that people wanted to live in a society where nothing would change their mind, where their thoughts would never be challenged. Well, that's what Hofstadter, in a sense, is talking about, a world in which we are never challenged, a world in which we spend our time with people who think much like ourselves, which, by the way, we do spend our time, not only in organizations, but in living patterns. As some of you may know, recent data suggests that far from red and blue states or red and blue counties, we live on red and blue city blocks and suburban blocks that actually, literally, blocks of cities and blocks of suburbs are identifiably, overwhelmingly, Republican or Democratic in their voting habits. We spend their time around people like ourselves. We spend our time talking to people who agree with us, partying with people who agree with us, reading the blogs of people who agree with us, watching the television stations where the commentators agree with us. The more time we spend with people who agree with us, the easier it is to look at those who disagree and say that the solution is so obvious, those people must be fools. There's a nice, simple reason that I believe X, and if you don't see it, there's only one of two possibilities. One possibility is that you are malevolent. You're intentionally not seeing the truth. The other possibility is that you're not seeing the truth because you're not smart enough. Either way, I don't owe you much obligation of respect. Hofstadter talked about this particular problem. Hofstadter said that when ideas become simple, our divisions become greater. That's Hofstadter said, when ideas become simple, our divisions become greater. Why do they become greater? Because when the ideas are simple, every battle is a matter of life and death. That's what Hofstadter said. Because there's the truth over here and the truth deniers over there, and there's nothing in between. Hofstadter argued, I think correctly, that only complexity can rescue democracy from a situation in which we are hopelessly divided, because we look at those who disagree with us and we see not opponents, not critics, but enemies. Now, I was a law clerk many years ago for Supreme Court Justice Thurgood Marshall, and I got to know him a little bit then. I got to know him better the last year of his life because as some of you may remember, he retired in 1991 and he died just a year and a half later. But the Federal Judicial Center asks retired justices to do oral history projects, and Justice Marshall asked me to be his interviewer for the oral history projects. We recorded these tapes about his life. We didn't finish before he died, but we got probably between 30 and 40 hours of tapes before Justice Marshall died. And we got what was, I think, the more important part. We didn't get much of the Supreme Court era, but we got his earlier life, which actually is, from the point of view of something mined by scholars or later biographers, much richer and much more important. Because you have to imagine, most people now who think of Marshall as a great justice, as I do, or as a great man, as I also do, they think of his vote. They look at the Supreme Court and the opinions he handed down and so on. But I think that to understand Marshall truly and to respect him truly, you have to look at what was really the better story, in a sense, which was his life before the court, a life in which not only did he litigate these civil rights cases and criminal cases all over the country for very little money, often literally at risk for his life, having to change cars to avoid a lynch mob, in one case, lynch mob led by the local sheriff, but also because the people he knew, the remarkable range of his acquaintances. He knew everybody, everyone who influenced 20th century America in a great way seemed to have been someone he encountered. And one of the things that struck me, both in the year that I was one of his law clerks and in the year and a half we did the oral history, was how rare it was for Marshall to speak ill of anyone, I'll give you one example of that. The Supreme Court decided Brown against Board of Education, the desegregation case, in 1954. Now, at that time, Thurgood Marshall was the lead lawyer for the plaintiffs, the parents who wanted to send their kids to integrated schools. There were five states that were on the other side, three southern states, one midwestern state, and one northern state, that wanted to maintain their segregated schools. They were worried they were going to lose the case. They went out and hired the man generally known as, at that time, as the best appellate lawyer in America. His name was John W. Davis, a former candidate for president of the United States, a brilliant lawyer, a partner in a Wall Street law firm, who also, interestingly, was a West Virginia and Virginia gentleman who genuinely believed in segregation. So years later, actually this is when I was one of Marshall's law clerks, not in the oral history, I asked him about John W. Davis, and I was about 25, 26 years old, and therefore by definition knew pretty much everything there is to know. And so I thought he would describe Davis in the terms which I would have described him at the time, heaping hellfire and damnation upon his head. But instead, what Marshall said, I've never forgotten his words, with no trace of facetiousness, he said, John W. Davis, a good man, a great man, who just happened to believe in that segregation. What it seemed to me that Marshall was saying there, teaching there, and what he taught over and over again, if you look at the transcripts of the oral history, which are all available at the Federal Judicial Center in Washington, what he was saying over and over again, and particularly there, was that he was able, across that great moral divide, to look at those on the other side and see them only as opponents rather than enemies, to see their common humanity. This wasn't just a matter of an aesthetic. It actually made a difference in his work. Because one of the reasons that I say he knew everyone, the reasons that matters, one of the great untold stories of Thurgood Marshall's life is the amount of time he spent, as he himself described it, in back rooms, playing cards and drinking whiskey, he would call it, with some of the leading segregationist politicians of the age, senators, governors, mayors. What he was doing in those back rooms was making deals to avoid some kind of disruption later on, a lawsuit, a demonstration, what have you. He was negotiating, and he could negotiate with them in part because they didn't feel that somehow he was treating them as less than human. I want to drop a footnote here. I am not saying that there are no issues on which the other side has to be destroyed. I'm not saying that. Indeed, I think each of us should have a list of issues where we think there is only one right side. So genocide, for example, is right up there at the top. The problem today is that we tend to have lists not of one or two issues, but of 30 or 40 issues apiece where there's only one right side. And you can't run a democracy that way. Now back to the story. So that was the Marshall component. Now some years after that, I happened to be out in Aspen, Colorado. I had lunch with a retiring politician, a member of Congress. He happened to be a Democrat, but that's not important to the story. Could as easily been a Republican. This was in the 90s. He was retiring after a long life in public service. And he was in despair. And those of us who were at lunch with him wanted to know what he was despairing about. And he referred to what he called the new crowd in Washington. And he meant Democrats and Republicans alike. And he told us a story. He said, back in the 60s, when he was cutting his eye teeth in politics, you could be on the floor of the House of Representatives and make a fiery speech about your opponent, and that night go out to dinner with them, and that weekend your kids would play together. And he said, the difference is with this new crowd, again, he's referring to both sides of the aisle, he said, with them it's personal. He said, with them it's personal. They genuinely don't like each other. and that's why they can't get anything done. Now, he attributed their not liking each other to the fact they'd never done anything together. He kept saying that his generation had gone through depression and war, and they'd gone through it together, so that you knew the person on the other side of the aisle that's experienced life experience is very similar to yours. Maybe that was the reason, but I would suggest another reason, that in the 1990s, we were really seeing the rise of simplicity. Simplicity as a tool of politics. We really began seeing in the 80s, it accelerated in the 90s, and now I fear that it is out of control. I fear that we live in an era now when it is common to think of those whom we disagree not as opponents, but as enemies and either evil or stupid. And to the extent that we move into that world, a world of what the novelist John Le Carré memorably called dangerous militant simplicity, our politics are going to get worse and worse. We have to find ways to resist the notion that all is simple. We have to find ways to resist the notion that there is no complexity, or the complexity is the enemy. And I genuinely believe that one of the ways we resist is through the medium of the book. Now, everyone in America, of course, agrees we have a literacy problem. We need more people to be able to read. That, of course, is true. But I'm speaking here not of literacy, but of books, actual physical books. I mentioned a moment ago that books symbolize complexity. The notion of a book is a notion that someone believed in an idea enough to create a form not easily expunged. It's not like a web page where you can make a mistake and go back and take it down if you change your mind. You're stuck with an idea that's in a book, and you're stuck with it for all time, or until the book crumbles into dust. I'm not saying that all books equally serve this purpose, but all books equally symbolize this purpose, the notion of complexity, the notion that ideas are hard. And I think the more time that we spend working our way through these physical tomes, the more we will begin to respect the complexity of issues, which will lead us automatically, I hope, to respect more those who disagree with us. Now, you might ask, why books rather than reading? What difference does it make whether you read a physical book or a screen of text? I'd like to believe that it makes no difference. I write in the online world, too, and I certainly read there voraciously, as I suspect that most of us do. But there is growing evidence, it's just evidence, it's not a certainty yet, there's growing evidence that it's not the same experience. There are a number of things that are measurably different in laboratory experiments when we read a physical book versus when we read a text online. There were some early studies suggesting that people don't retain as much when they read a screen of text versus a book, but those have mostly been overturned. It looks like, at this point, we could fairly say that people retain as much with a book or with a text online, even getting to read the text online, because one of the problems with text online, it turns out, is that people don't like to read to the end. If you give someone a 750-word op-ed, that's a column in the New York Times, they'll read that. The same op-ed online is at least 2 and possibly 3 pages. You've got to click through. A lot of people read just the first page and then click off to somewhere else. So that's a bit of a problem. But if you can get people to read the stuff, the retention rate is about the same. But there are other things that are very different. In particular, creativity. There's a lot of evidence, there's some evidence with studies with little children that when you give children a children's book to read, and it's in book form, and you give them the same story on a screen, they will retain and understand the story just as well. But when you ask them to do something creative with it, the children who had it in book form do much better. So when you ask, what do you think should happen next to this little girl in the story? Or if you were a character in the story, who would you want to be? Questions like that, they require them to interact creatively with what they're reading. The students who read it in book form do much better. Now, the reason that matters, these are kids. You do the same studies with adults, you'll get similar results, but with adults, you can say it's an artifact, because adults are accustomed to reading books they've done all their lives. Kids who are just learning to read, it turns out, have exactly the same problem. there's a number of researchers who believe that not only creativity, but imagination decreases. That, in other words, that young people who tend to read online are not themselves, some researchers believe, as capable of thinking imaginatively later on. That you say to a child, write a story. Turns out children who've been reading stories in book form can do that better than children who are reading stories online. Now, as to why this is, nobody knows. As to whether these results will hold stable over time, nobody knows. But they point in a worrisome direction. Because to the extent we begin to lose the ability to think imaginatively and think creatively, we may lose the ability to think empathetically. That seems to me to be part of imagination. What is empathy but imagining yourself in someone else's place? And if we can, in a democracy, be empathetic, then it's even more difficult to think that there could actually be more than one side of a hot political question. What we might forget, in other words, is that sometimes the reason that an issue is deeply divisive is because people of goodwill can think about it and come to different conclusions. Sometimes it's divisive because it's a hard issue, not because it's an easy issue in which one side is right and one side is just somehow idiotic. There's something else I want to mention also along this line. Two more things, then I want to stop and take your questions and comments. A number of libraries have stopped, for all intents and purposes, functioning as libraries. They've been shipping a lot of their books away. The Yale Law Library keeps much less of its collection here to be browsed, for example. And some of them are renaming themselves things like resource centers, information centers, and things like that. The problem with this trend, and I recognize the budgetary constraints that create it, but the problem with it is, once again, it reduces the idea of book to a source of information. That is, if there's a book you need, we'll get it for you. Or you can get this information online. But what makes libraries special is not principally that they are sources of information, it's that they're sources of books, that they're sources of a particular tool invented 1,000 or so years ago, a particular tool that holds information in a particular form that seems uniquely suited, not only to human use, but especially to the needs of a democracy. It's quite striking that many of the great thinkers of the 17th, 18th, and 19th centuries, Diderot, Bacon, there are many others, at some point in their careers turned to the question of how should we organize and categorize human knowledge? What should a library look like? That question doesn't detain us as much anymore. Many of you know that Google has announced the intention to put all of human information online. What I want to suggest is that's impossible. You can put every page of every book online, and that's not a bad idea. But it won't transmit the same information as it does when you touch it and hold it. I happen to collect certain antiquarian books, and if I go into a bookstore and I pick up a first edition, say, of Thackeray or Eliot, that's a different experience than simply knowing what Thackeray or Eliot said. Someone else held this book, and someone else before him or her, and someone else, and someone else, and someone else. I'm holding the object through which others enjoyed the same story, the same argument, the same experience that I'm about to enjoy. The tangibility of the book itself suggests ideas that are important to democracy. The idea of permanence, the idea of solidity, the idea of standing for the ages. If we relegate books in the end to museum pieces, and we relegate information to simply people getting what they want in the easiest and quickest way possible, we will be acceding to great changes in what it means to be a democracy. The decline of books isn't causing those changes, but a resurrection of books, a renaissance of books, I think would help to slow them and maybe even to reverse them. Because we need, I think, to realize that vision that Hofstadter presented 50 years ago, a democracy that believes in reason an argument and tolerance of disagreement rather than one that believes in emotional appeal, slogans, applause lines, and lists of people to hate. Thank you very much. Now, thank you. We have time for questions if you have any. I just ask, there's microphones here, they're recording this, so if you can possibly come to the microphone to ask a question or make a comment. I also ask that you keep your questions or comments fairly short in case, so others can have a chance. And finally, be warned that I will exercise my prerogative as a professor to answer sometimes the question that I wish you'd ask instead of the question that you actually, the question you actually asked. Go ahead.
You spoke briefly about Thurgood Marshall socializing with people that he was on the other side of the...
I don't think I used the word socializing, but go on.
Well, did you say gambling? I'd like you to talk a little bit more about that.
I did say gambling.
Building of relationships in that way.
Sure. The question is about, yes, I mentioned Thurgood Marshall. What I said was sitting in back rooms and playing cards and drinking whiskey with people with whom we disagreed. I can talk a little bit more about that. A couple of things I want to mention. In the Oral History Project, one of the devices that I used, very common for interviewers, we went year by year, but as each year or era came up, I would throw out names and simply invite Justice Marshall to talk about those people as he remembered them. And one of the things that was striking to me was the people for whom he had affection. He never said anything bad about anyone, with one or two minor exceptions, but quite famously, for example, he didn't like Malcolm X. That's a very well-known fact of history, and he didn't say anything nice about him, but those are fairly minor exceptions. But what was striking to me, what I would imagine is, who do you think his favorite presidents were? And he knew pretty much all of them from the 1920s on. His favorite presidents, of course, were Harry Truman and Lyndon Johnson. And why Harry Truman and Lyndon Johnson? Well, they were backroom, old-fashioned politicians with whom you could sit down and have a drink. And one thing that was striking about Marshall, when he talked about people he'd known, the highest praise that he would bestow was, you could do business with him. That's it, you could do business with him. And all he meant by that was if you made a deal in the back room or anywhere else and you shook hands, his word was good. So when he criticized people, he would often criticize people for breaking their word. That was a big problem for him when you would sit down and make a deal and the person would do something else instead. For Marshall, that was a particular offense. But my main point in talking about Marshall is not who he idolized and who he didn't. It's rather this notion that you can actually have across great divides, not every great divide, but across many great divides, you can have this kind of civil discourse rooted, in Marshall's case, I think, in actual human respect for others. Now, I want to make clear, I don't claim that I myself always share that, but that's my aspiration. I think that's the right aspiration to have. But I also want to emphasize what I said before. I think that it is part of being a thoughtful and reasoning person that we should all of us, by our studies of history and the world, have a list. In one of my books, I think my book on integrity, I said it should be two or three issues on which we think there's only one side. And I think that's part of being thoughtful. We shouldn't, as someone once said, be so open-minded that our brains fall out. But those lists should be short, because when we make the lists long, I worry that all we're really trying to do is avoid debate, avoid facing up to the possibility that the people on the other side may have a point. So if you're talking about the Nazis, it seems to me, you're talking about the physical extermination of other human beings, it seems to be folly to pretend that, well, maybe they have a point of view and we need to listen to what they have to say. But I think the list should be short. I think the list should be a very short one for each of us. It may not be the same for each of us. That's part of human diversity. But it should be a short list for each of us. Our list should not have 10 or 15 or 20 different issues on it. Go ahead.
Yeah, maybe you could talk for a minute about how you're feeling about, on the one hand, the continuing use of kind of jargonizing the political dialogue that I see even the Obama administration falling into, at the same time that clearly he is not demifying people in the sense and is clearly looking to change the nature of the dialogue in terms of making lists about who you hate and don't get along with. I mean, I don't know.
Well, as I said, let me answer the question that I wish you asked instead. Let me slightly restate the question. I'm going to pretend that what you asked is, are there signs in the current era that make me optimistic? Okay, how about if we put it that way? And the answer is yes, but I have to confess, I'm optimistic in every era. I always see signs, and people always say I'm an idiot, that things are just getting worse and the rats have taken over the ship and so on, depending on who you talk to. In different years, different rats, according to different people, because I try to hang out with people with multiple points of view, and so, you know, today I'm with these people on the left, tomorrow I'm with these people on the right, and I hear, so there's different stories about who the rats are, but what's consistent is the story. So the rats have taken over the ship and we're all going to drown unless we overthrow them somehow or something. Now, here's the thing. I think that the problems I've described are sufficiently ingrained that it's difficult to imagine a single politician, no matter how popular or charismatic or a single political era, overturning them. Let me give you an example of what I mean. Every 4 years when we have a presidential election, we have these things, that's all I can call them, things, that are called presidential debates. Right? Now, I would abolish these things. I would get rid of them. They are not debates. They are joint news conferences that are largely about the moderator whose job it is to make sure the answers are short enough to convey no information whatsoever. It's really true. Think about a typical presidential debate. You say each of them, Senator so-and-so, Governor so-and-so, tell us how you would reduce the interest rate on our foreign debt without raising taxes at home while maintaining a reasonable balance of trade. You have 30 seconds. That's what you get in the presidential debates. The candidates barely have time to tell you what their position is. They have no time to tell you why they believe it. And therefore, they can never have the opportunity to persuade you. Now, you might say, well, that's what their speeches are for, but it isn't. It's not what their speeches are for. In fact, it's really quite striking. If you read presidential speeches as opposed to listening to them, you realize they are virtually devoid of substance. And there's a reason for that. It's perfectly rational. This is the reason. In the 1980 election cycle, the average presidential soundbite in the evening news, and by soundbite, what I mean here is something very specific. This is the amount of uninterrupted time that you heard the candidate in his own voice describing his own views, a clip from today's speech, was 42 seconds, right? In the 2004 election cycle, the last for which we have data, it was 7 seconds. You've got to think about that for a minute. That means that every speechwriter knows that some 7-second snippet of this speech is all that most voters will ever know about. Therefore, the candidate cannot say anything remotely controversial because one will never hear the paragraph before and after, only hear only the 7 seconds. That's where part of the problem lies, that it's become difficult to get information, and it's become so difficult that candidates worry about the same thing on the web. If you look at the candidates' websites in the last presidential election, one of the things that was really striking was they were full of proposals, but there were very few explanations or justifications, except for a few applause lines for the proposals. And there's a reason for that. It's not because the candidates are idiots. It's because they're smart, because they know all they need is an explanation that is susceptible to being cut up into little pieces, and those little pieces will rocket around the internet, you see, before truth can get its boots on. Now, I'm a Lincoln buff. I like Lincoln. I like reading about Lincoln. If you ever pick up the Basler, and the Basler, as some of you may know, is the collected Lincoln works edited by Professor Basler. If you look at the Basler, if you page to the Lincoln-Douglas debates, you can easily find one of Lincoln's answers went on for 13 pages. Now, it was a different world. People went to political speeches for entertainment. There was no television, there was no radio, there was no recorded music. I'm not saying you have to let people go on for 13 pages, but somewhere between 7 seconds and 13 pages, it seems to me there's a happy medium, especially if the news media were actually to be persuaded that the important part of the job is informing us about what's going on. I'll tell you one more small story about that. I wrote a book many years ago about the confirmation process for federal judges and Supreme Court justices. And after I wrote the book, I met a retired reporter who had covered Thurgood Marshall's confirmation hearings, which were the nastiest, I think, in her history, but weren't on television, who had covered Thurgood Marshall's confirmation hearings for a major newspaper. And I had read his accounts when I was working on the book. And we happened to meet socially. And I said to him, you know, I read your accounts, and I noticed there was a lot of stuff that went on in the hearing room that didn't make it into your stories. And he said, that's because in those days we had a thing called news judgment. Now, he actually drew a link between the coverage of those hearings in the McCarthy era. Because this is the way he put his point. He said, look, suppose you're sitting there in the hearing room as a reporter and you hear Senator Eastland call Thurgood Marshall a communist. Right? Said, well, the thing you put it in context, Eastland calls everybody a communist. It's not newsworthy. He said, if you do the work and you discover Thurgood Marshall is a communist, it's newsworthy. If you do then you've got a story, Thurgood Marshall's a communist. If you do the work and you discover he's not a communist, you've got a story, Eastland's a liar. But if you don't want to do the work, then you don't report the allegation. And he went on to talk about people being destroyed by allegations all through the 1950s, and the press had been going this period of soul searching and just stopped reporting these unsubstantiated allegations, which of course isn't true anymore. And he said, but once television gets a hold of it, you can't do that. You can't make those judgments. So I was on a panel some years ago about press coverage of politics, and I told that story. And next to me was a famously muckraking reporter was sitting next to me, who was the next person along, and I told this story. And he turned to me and he said that this reporter, who I didn't name, was wrong. He was just wrong. It was not the duty of the press, he said, to serve as a filter like that. And my view is, then, what is the duty of the press if not to make actual news judgments? But that was, you know, I guess that was a different era, an era when news was carried by the printed word. Yes, right here. And then I'll get yours. I see you've been waiting. Go ahead.
I'll offer you an observation and ask for your comment because it's
a brief observation.
It's on your thesis.
Because I'm told, by the way, we have to clear the room exactly 11 o'clock, so we have 7 minutes left. But go ahead.
I spent 12 years in Washington and a good bit of it at the bars where the House frequents, which is Bullfeathers now, and it used to be Loyal Opposition. On the other side is the Monocle. And I observed, and see if it meets with you, your thinking as well, that nothing got passed in Congress until it had, in fact, been reduced to a short statement on a cocktail napkin by a committee chairman. And I call that the cocktail party rule in one of my books. Do you see the same thing, that simplicity is a problem in Congress, not just in the electorate?
Well, simplicity, I think that's a very good point. Simplicity and complexity in Congress play a very different role, because legislation tends to be enormously complex, but it's described in very simple terms. One of the promised reforms that I really liked, which hasn't been fully instituted by this Congress, was to put every piece of legislation online long enough for people actually to study it and read it and understand it before it's voted on, to in effect create a public comment period. We haven't done that. There have been some, but that's actually been a minority of pieces of legislation. There's always such a sense of urgency. Everything has to be passed today or tomorrow, which I don't fully understand. I think that's forcing us by the 24-hour news cycle. There are very few bills that if you waited a week to pass them, some great national disaster would strike. There are some, but I think you can count them on one hand, something that has to be passed today instead of tomorrow. So it is true that what tends to happen is the bills are enormously complex, and the supporters and opponents go on talk shows and so on and describe it in little one-sentence blurbs, which are all, since most people aren't going to read the bill, certainly not before it passes. That's all that we often hear about them. I don't like that process at all. Yes.
Should torture rendition and the invasion of Iraq be on our short list, and are they on yours?
I'm sorry, torture and rendition and the invasion of Iraq?
Voila.
Should be on our short list. The question is...
The short list you described.
No, I understand what you're saying. I'm not going to tell you what should be on your short list. I'm interested in what should be on other people's short list. It strikes me, I write and teach about the rule of the law of war and the ethics of war, just war theory. And I'll just speak to that one, that while I myself happen to be an opponent of the war of Iraq, I don't agree with those who think that it was not justifiable. There are certainly justifications that could be offered. That's one of the weaknesses, by the way, as a footnote. One of the weaknesses of international law with respect to armed conflict is that the law is sufficiently vague that actually justify a lot of wars, that international law is a very low roadblock to fighting wars. That's why I teach a course on the ethics of war, because since we will never control war through international law, we have to control it through a set of understood informal norms, and I'm interested in developing the informal norms of what war should be. I'm working on a book now, actually, in which I'm talking about the fact that international law takes as given that you can go to war to defend your own country, but is skeptical of claims of going to war to defend someone else. So that if country A invades country B, everyone agrees country B can fight, but if country A is slaughtering its own people, international law says there's nothing really country B can do about it. And I find that troubling. If you look back to one of the earliest writers in just war, Augustine, Augustine gave this famous example. He said, suppose you're walking through the woods and you're set upon by robbers who mean to kill you and take your purse. He said, you have the right to defend yourself, but you don't have the responsibility to defend yourself. You can decide instead to say, I will not raise my hand against one of God's creatures even to save my own life and let them kill you. Then he says, suppose that you're walking through the woods and you see someone else is being set upon by robbers. He said, you have a responsibility to defend that person. That your claim about I will not raise my hands, as Augustine, can be used to abnegate self-defense, but not to say you have no responsibility for going to the aid of another. So you have in this very early writing about just war the notion that defending others is a higher claim than defending yourself, and it's been reduced over the centuries, or been reversed over the centuries, the notion that defending yourself is the highest and most obvious claim, and that's something that I've written about and taught about, and I'm writing a book about actually right now. Yes.
Well, that leads me to a question. Developing international law of the right to protect under in the United Nations, is that something that you think is the right to protect under international law? Is it developing?
I'm sorry I mentioned international law, now we're going to go down this road. All right, the right to protect international law. There isn't a right to protect really international law except to protect yourself. There's a genocide convention which requires all the signatories to stop acts of genocide wherever they are. You may have seen that wonderful, if depressing movie, Hotel Rwanda, and there's the scene in the movie Hotel Rwanda when the people holed up in the hotel are listening to the spokesperson of the Secretary of State being asked by reporters, is what's going on in Rwanda genocide? And she keeps saying, well, acts of genocide may have occurred. There's a reason behind that. The reason that she put it that way is that if she said genocide was occurring, then the United States would be obligated by treaty to put a stop to it. The treaty doesn't specify force, but it's widely understood that's what the treaty means, which is why nothing's ever done under it. No country has ever acted under the genocide treaty to prevent genocide in another country. But maybe we can get back to the subject of books and bumper stickers. Yes, right there.
In the reduction to simplicity in politics, does wedge politics amplify it? And then does the big money amplify the wedge politics? In other words, there's an investment, and the investors expect an ROI, right or wrong, true or false.
Right, the question is, on the question of reducing its simplicity, does wedge politics change that, and in particular, does investment of money make it worse? Let me answer those questions in reverse. Yes, investment of money makes it worse, but I don't think you can do anything about that. I should explain, and here I'm in a minority in the Yale faculty, but I'm probably as close to a First Amendment absolutist as exists on the Yale faculty. I really genuinely believe the government has no business, except in the most extraordinary cases, interfering with speech. And so the notion that the government can limit how much money people can spend on campaigns, here I'm speaking of other people, I think it's unconstitutional. The Supreme Court disagrees with me, and they have more power than I do, so let's take it that I'm wrong. But I'm telling you my view, nevertheless. So the answer is, I think that there's two different ways of looking at the problem you've described. There's one of the things that the investment of money does is it allows people to run, put aside the influence it may buy, allows people to run commercials that oversimplify issues enormously. And these commercials bother me, even when I think they're right, they're on the right side, a commercial can be on the right side, and yet still be an oversimplification that I think is harmful to the notion of dialogue in a democracy. So that's just very harmful. And let me talk about one minor version of the first part of your question. What about voters who just care about a single issue? What about, you've got single issue voters out there. Then there's not that many. People who study elections professionally have discovered that actually the single issue voter is largely a myth. But there are some. And in a very close election, there may be enough to swing votes, especially in this last election. It looked like, it's not entirely sure, it looks like in this last election there were a fair number of one-issue voters whose issue was Iraq. But typically, the one-issue voters are on abortion, on either side, by the way. In fact, a lot of theorists think that the one-issue pro-choice voters outnumber the one-issue pro-life voters. Whatever the reason, there are some one-issue voters out there. And I think there's nothing wrong with having some one-issue voters out there as long as there's a diversity of one-issue voters. That is, if every voter is voting on the same one issue, that's really bad. But if you've got 50 different one-issue coalitions, that's not a bad thing. That's pluralism. That's what makes democracy work. Ideally, you should be shifting coalitions with people on this side on this issue, on that side on that issue. So, you know, the pure libertarian who's with, say, the Republicans on guns and the Democrats on abortion or something like that. That's the kind of pluralistic shifting coalition that's supposed to be very important to make politics work. When coalitions become permanent, when they don't break up, when they don't fragment, when the issues don't change, that's when you tend to see democracy break down, even though voting still works, but democracy tends to break down at that point. So we have time for one more question, if there is one more. Yes, right, ma'am, right there. Yeah. The question was, if you didn't hear it, with the current media to which young people are exposed, blogging, Twitter, television, other things, being online all the time, how does one swim upstream against it? It's very hard. It's very hard. Two quick things about that. One is that there are various estimates. Put aside just the sheer amount of media that kids consume. They also consume a lot of advertising along with that media. By some estimates, as many as 3,000 commercial messages in a single day, depending what you measure as exposure to. And there's a lot of, this is an area in which my wife, who works in this area, who runs something called the Motherhood Project, I think it's recently been renamed Mothers for a Human Future, has done a lot of work studying the impact of television, well, of advertising generally, on young people. And the impact is pretty severe. I won't get all the data here, the data that most people, I think, probably already know. It's a big problem, but all I will say is that it is a problem that is not resolved through abandonment of adult responsibility. You have to recognize that we're raising the first generation of young people that has built its own subculture. That is, when all of us were growing up, it was difficult to get to us for our friends except through an adult. All phones were landlines. Your parents knew how much time you were spending on the phone, and often they knew who you were talking to on the phone. If you wanted to go to your friend's house, your parents knew where you were going, when you were coming back, and so on. With cell phones and various means of online and other digital communication, you live in a world in which, well, whatever rules parents may think they're setting about their household, young people built their own subculture in which they communicate and act together in concert without regard to adult rules. And that is unprecedented in human history. I'm not saying it's a bad thing. We don't know yet. It's one of those things I wish I could look at the answers in the back of the book, look at this generation and its children and see. You know, I study history and I like to look at the long view. I don't know what it's going to be. It's just going to be something different than what we've been accustomed to before. My hope is that whatever world they build, we will help them build it in a way that does not exclude the book as a tool. The book is an enormously important part of being a functioning citizen of democracy, again, because of what it symbolized. I would like to see all of these young people forced to make their way through difficult books and write difficult essays about them, simply to expose them to the idea of complexity, which is an idea without which I think democracy can't function. Thank you very much.